this guy. So World 5, which I represent now, is a AIF Cat 1 fund with about 100 crores as our targeted money, which we have for investment. And we started, we got our license in January, and we started touching base with investors to get them to invest with us. And September, we've done our first close. And pipeline, in the meantime, we also built up our pipeline of various investment companies, which we wanted to evaluate. And in October, we had our first IC committee meeting, or the investment committee meeting. And we have shortlisted the first startup that we are going to invest in. Of course, all the public announcements are yet to happen. They'll happen over a period of time. But we have closed. And now almost every month, we are looking at least one or two startups to invest in. And we keep reviewing various opportunities that come our way. So the startup ecosystem is very interesting. We see all kinds of startups. We see people who come with good ideas, bad implementation. We see people who come with bad ideas, great marketing, poor implementation. We see all kinds of people. But we are able to sift using our experience over the last 30 years that we have been working in this industry. We are able to sift and see what are the different kinds of people that are there, what are the projects that they are talking about, how to look at those projects, how do we analyze ye sach bol raha hai ya jhoot bol raha hai, ya kitna isme sach hai, kitna isme jhoot hai. And we are able to analyze and figure out ki kiske piche hume paisa lagana. But at the same time, I must caution that it is not necessary that we are always right in our decisions. And we know it. We know it that in spite of all the filters that I may use in analyzing and identifying a startup, I could still go wrong. So it could be a situation where we know that out of every 10 investments that we will do, almost 5 to 6 of them will fail in spite of all the precautions that we have taken in deciding on where to invest our money. The balance 4 to 5 who are there, out of them, there may be just 1 or 2 who will probably give us bumper rewards. The rest would be average investments. Now, mind you, we are a fund, which means somebody is investing money with us, and we are like fund managers. It's our responsibility to identify the right startups to put our money in and monitor the progress over a period of time. But we also have a mandate that the investor's money needs to be returned back to him over a period, let's say after a gap of about 5 to 7 years. And an investor comes on board with the pure perspective that mujhe kya milega? Maine aapko ek crore diya, aap mujhe kitna return karoge 5 saal baad, 7 saal baad. So very clearly for us, when we look at startups, we only would like to invest with those startups where we can exit in 5 years' time. If we don't see an exit possibility in 5 years' time, we would not want to put our money there. So these are some backgrounds with which we would operate. So to me, the journey begins by first analyzing who's the entrepreneur, then analyzing what's the startup, and then moving on to the final deck, the pitch deck, where you just get 10 slides, 10, 15 minutes of presentation, and either you make it or break it at the investment committee presentations. Is it clear so far? I hope it makes sense to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Let me begin by sharing this presentation. So primarily, I think what is important is, it is not just the deck, but the entire ecosystem is that what you need to understand. So to us, we start by analyzing the entrepreneur. we want to look at what is this mindset. So many a time before we do the final check writing of a startup, we would have gone through multiple calls with that entrepreneur. And every time we would have evaluated him on various aspects about his personality, his thought process, his culture, and the way he is looking at the whole business. So to us, some of the things that are very critical to look for is how focused is he? We would also look at, is he open to learning? Is he open to iterations? Has he failed a couple of times and has come back again with more vigor and more stronger mind? Is he curious to try and see if there are better ways of handling the same problem? At the same time, is he driving his entire enterprise from an optimistic perspective? At the same time, we also want to know, is he flexible? And does he have the patience to hold on? Because a startup journey is full of obstacles. There are times when things just don't happen and you're wondering as to where have I got into. So for us, it's very important to understand what's his mindset. So for us, an entrepreneur is somebody who has all the positives in him on all these parameters. We look at somebody who thinks innovatively and is willing to act on that innovation. Very critical for us. There are various kinds of entrepreneurs. You have somebody we sort of put them into four buckets. So either he's a builder type, he's a specialist, he could be an opportunist, or he could be an innovator. For us, the builder type is really the best guy because he works on creating a building with a very, very strong foundation. And then he's building the structure on top of that foundation. And the business is scalable. So it can move from one story to 25 stories without having to rebuild the foundation. So to us, a builder entrepreneur is a great guy in our checklist to look at. Somebody who's a specialist, he tends to be focused on a certain domain, may not understand the other domains that are required. In an entrepreneurial journey, you need to understand every aspect of the business. It is not just saying that I'm a technical expert. I don't understand how to talk to customers, or I don't understand how am I going to manage the finance side of it. You need to know little of everything. But if he's a specialist, we are worried. But we're okay if this specialist has co-founders who bring in the rest of the remaining skills where he is weak. The third type is the opportunist. He's typically a guy who will see an opportunity and jump the bandwagon. Some of them succeed, some of them fail. But most of them as opportunists are very, very short term in their approach. And for example, abhi COVID ho gaya, toh he'll say, COVID ke liye batao kya kar sakte hain. Kya startup create kare is time pe. And as soon as the COVID thing fades, he also fades. His enterprise also fades. So it's an opportunistic approach that he will have. And somebody like him is not for the long haul. So we wouldn't want to invest in somebody like him. An innovator is somebody who sees that there is a problem. He ideates, he works on building a solution. And with that solution, he brings it to the marketplace and makes it a commercially viable product. This guy, again, tends to be generally a highly techie guy and may not be strong in other areas in terms of financial management, raising funds, or doing the sales and marketing. So as long as he's able to make good with other partners who can help him in those areas, we're fine to look at him. There are lots of these myths that people have that, you know, when you become an entrepreneur, you should not quit. Or an entrepreneur knows exactly what he wants. Or that he's a guy who knows how to get it. he's his own boss and he's well connected, he's rich. And that entrepreneurship requires deep pockets. Frankly, these are all myths. For us, an entrepreneur who has not quit, we were worried about him because he doesn't know what the downside of the business is. He's only seen the good side of it. And in case a downside happens, if there's a downturn cycle, he doesn't know how to handle it. So we like people who have failed having set up a couple of entrepreneurial journeys. So to us, if somebody has failed, he is a more stronger person to bounce back. Another aspect is we have seen that many a times the entrepreneur starts at point A, but by the time he actually evolves the product and takes it to the market, it has evolved to something else. So many a times he may not know. He knows there is a problem and he's figured out there is one way of handling it, but may not really work. And as he goes, he does the iterations and improvises on it. He may not know how to go about doing everything by himself. So he needs mentors who can guide him, who can assist him in re-looking at that solution to say whether this is a right way to go forward or not. He doesn't need to be well connected. He doesn't need to be wealthy. Today, money is available for a startup ecosystem. There are enough investors who are sitting with funds who are wondering where can he get returns. This investor is somebody who has already made his money. He's got his own house. He's got his own property. He's invested in real estate. He's invested in the mutual funds. He's invested in gold. He's invested in bitcoins, but he still has got funds left. And he wonders, where can I put my money? And he knows the return that is going to happen if he puts the money in a fixed deposit, if he puts that money in the stock market. He knows the returns, but he's hungry for more returns. At the same time, this entrepreneur, this investor is somebody who's also willing to take risk. So they are willing to put money behind great ideas, as long as they get that comfort that this guy will deliver. So you don't really require deep pockets in today's environment. But then we also need to remember that when you start your entrepreneurial journey, you are like a one-man show. You are the CEO, you are the chaprasi. You are the salesman, you are the accounts guy. You are the guy who's done doing the client servicing, you are the guy who's also reviewing the financial situation. So frankly, many a times, people who have worked in the industry and have reached certain levels, when they start their entrepreneurial journey, they find it very difficult because they've been used to sitting on that hot seat of being the boss. And now he figures out that he has to run to make a call to a client. He has to run to deliver a proposal to somebody, or he has to run to even meet a wealth manager so that he can seek funding or come to a fund for servicing. So today he is somebody who is a Superman rolled in one. And the worst part is, as an entrepreneur, you cannot blame anyone for anything that goes wrong. But anyone and everyone can blame you for everything that has gone wrong. So your mental faculties have to be tuned to understand that these are some things which will come to me as part of my journey as an entrepreneur. And you should be strong in your mind to take this all in the right spirit and move on with a clear focus as to what you want to achieve. So like I shared, quitting is not a bad issue. You can quit if you have done enough in that activity and have figured out that this one's not working. So I need to do something else. I need to do something different. So quit, start all over again, not a big deal. But in case you decide to go on with that venture, then you must remember that it's a long journey. There are no shortcuts. While along the way, you can define your goals, you can define your milestones and decide to celebrate them with your team. So this is how an entrepreneur will start building up his journey. So to recap, your first iteration of an idea may be wrong. You may have to work long hours. There is no concept of vacations when you're an entrepreneur. many a times folks at home, your girlfriend or your wife, may not really understand what you're trying to do and may not really be with you. They may superficially support you, but they may not necessarily support you. Mentally be prepared for it. And many a times, if you have had a kind of job where you're getting a salary and you're jumping into the entrepreneurial journey, you may not get that kind of salary that you were getting. And that salary may not happen for a while, sometimes even longer. Yeah, you may take home some expenses money that you will generate out of the income, but you really can't take a salary. And as investors from the fund side, we do look at what the entrepreneur is taking home as salary, because we take, you know, the top key employees database from them before we invest to see whether the CEO is taking just 50,000 while he's paying the techie head whom he's hired as a job, he's paying him 1.5 lakhs, because that's a specialized technique that he needs and he needs that guy. So to us, we feel strong about an entrepreneur who hardly takes any money but gives his team all the money that they need to get them to do their jobs. So in a nutshell, when I look at the entrepreneur, we look for 3 aspects of his brain. These we identify when we speak to an entrepreneur. So when we talk to an entrepreneur, we will ask him questions and we seek answers on the way he would handle those kind of situations. So we create situations and ask him, if this happens, what will you do? If this would happen, how will you handle it? Or has this ever happened to you? So we try to go back and see how his journey has been and how has he handled it. A reptile is the most primitive form, which means he's somebody who is strong at survival. So when his cash burn does not allow him to have any money and he is in a bad state of affairs, how does he still manage to run that enterprise? How does he manage to keep the team going? Has he gone through that phase, that paisa hi nahi hai company mein? But product has reached a level where another 1 month and 2 months, the product will be out and you will start generating revenue. Does he have ideas how to handle a situation like that? Has he been through that so far in his journey? If he's strong and he knows the skills of a reptile, he will learn to survive. So he's seen the worst case scenario and he knows how to handle it. The monkey brain is the other aspect that we look at. A monkey brain typically is something where, you know, the guy has been very clear, because day in and day out, you do the same thing. When once you started your journey, there are a lot of things which are common that you're doing. He does that and he gets his team to do that. Everybody does that task, a repetitive task, in a very controlled manner on an ongoing basis. Very critical for us, because we are not looking for people who are doing this entrepreneurial journey as a hobby. Ki aaj mood hai, kar lete hain kaam, ya kal chutti karte hain, 10 din ke baad dekhenge. No, we want something where that repetitiveness of work is also maintained. And last but not the least, for us, the builder brain is very critical, because that guy is going to ensure that he's laid a very, very strong foundation for that business model. And for him to scale up that business when the business starts growing is not a difficult proposition. So, of course, there are upsides. There are not just difficult situations or obstacles. You are your own boss. You can decide when you want to work. But at the same time, we believe that as an entrepreneur, you will work. You can decide when to work. That gives you flexibility. And of course, if you have the passion for the pain area that you're handling, there's a lot of excitement, there's a lot of satisfaction that you get. And many a times you can think, why should I choose the beaten path? Why don't I think of doing it in a different manner? So this out-of-box thinking is some things which you may try. Some of them may work, some of them may not work, but you are at least open to trying it out. and that flexibility is there. The day you are working in a company, trust me, all these things are not there. You are never your own boss. You cannot decide ki nahi main raat ko kaam karunga, din mein nahi karunga. You have to be very staid and straight in your approach when you work for organizations. And there are limited ways. That does not mean that an entrepreneur remains his own boss. The day an investor comes and sits on top of you, you have a boss. Because that guy who is putting money does not put money without asking you any questions from time to time. And because it is his money, he has a right to ask. So this freedom to that extent tends to get curtailed. So to us, what are the key ingredients? Before you do a startup, most important for you is to understand what is the pain area that you are wanting to resolve. And frankly, most of the time, the pain areas are something that you see in your surroundings on a daily basis. It is not something which you have to think out of this world. In your daily life, you come across problems and you figure out a way to handle it. Paytm is a classic case that we can look at. He figured out that you needed a wallet. You don't need to carry cash all the time. And he gave a solution, which today has become like a mainstay. So much so that there are so many wallets of different names, but a lot of them colloquially will use the word Paytm kar dena. He's reached that level of acceptance. You look at any of the other startups. Today you want to buy on Amazon, you want to buy on a Flipkart, or you want to use Cred for your credit card management. All of these are becoming generic in nature because they found out that there is a pain area and we need to figure out how to solve it. So there are so many ideas that people are working with. The other thing that as an entrepreneur must remember is, while you may think of an idea, you are not the only one. We have 7 billion people on this earth. The same idea could be thought about by several thousands of people. A lot of them may be pure cribbers. Yaar, koi iska solve kyun nahi karta? Itni serious problem hai. Koi iska ilaaj kyun nahi dhoondta? A part of them would say, yeah, main iska ilaaj dhoondta hoon. And they get down to doing it. But now the choice that you have is how well you implement that idea is how it will decide the future of that startup. So the idea per se is not the only thing. Most important thing that we look for before we invest is to see what is his implementation model. For us, that implementation model will help us understand whether he's on the right path for success or not. I'm talking to an institute, so I should not use the word, but you don't need a degree to become an entrepreneur. But yes, you need to understand a lot of things about business. And a journey through an institute will help you get that rounded experience before you jump into it. So very clearly, these are the questions we look for answers when we talk to an entrepreneur as to, are there any clear customer benefits? We're not interested in entrepreneurs who look for only their own benefit. They should be doing a good to the world and making money out of it. But if they're not doing good to the world, it doesn't interest us. At the same time, we want to ensure that whatever targets that he's taking, he converts them into goals, milestones, and they are measurable. Because when we decide to invest, let's say if I decide to invest 1 crore or 10 crores with any startup, we will not give the entire money up front. We will define milestones after milestones after milestones. And we will say, aap ye first 3 months mein ye achieve karo, aapko agla 50 lakh milega. आप अगले 3 महीने में ये अचीव करो तो आपको अगला 1 crore मिलेगा. So on and so forth. So what really happens is that unless there are clear measurable goals, which mind you are being laid down by the entrepreneur himself when he shares the deck with us, we hold him responsible for those commitments. Then we look at his approach in terms of whether he listens to people. whether he listens to his team. We see so many entrepreneurs who like to listen to their own voice. They are not willing to listen to their own team members. They are not even willing to take the product in its prototype stage to customers to understand whether is this exactly what they want, or does this product require any kind of modification. So to us, that listening skill is very, very critical in an entrepreneur. And it all entrepreneurial journey anyways is risk-taking. But at the same time, he should be somebody who builds on relationship, who thrives on relationship, whether it is with his team, whether it is with his customers, whether it is with the investment community. We like to look for people who are working on building relationships. There's a reason behind why we give a lot of weightage to this. As a fund, today, when you start your journey, you go to an angel investor who gives you your first 50,000, 1 lakh, 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs. When you have used it, you brought the product to a certain level. Let's say it's come to a stage where the proof of concept is clear and you're now ready to roll out and start generating the first revenues. You do that and you reach a level where now you want the next level of funds to take you from that proof of concept to a revenue generating model. You will go to a fund, a small fund, who handles anywhere between 1 crore to 10 crore like us. You would come to us. We don't do angel funding, okay? So we will come at the second stage when you have a product which is viable and we know that you can generate revenues, you have started generating revenues, minuscule maybe, but you know that you're generating revenues. So now we will look at investing with you and taking you from that, let's say, 1 lakh revenue to the 1 crore revenue. We'll take you through that journey. We'll support you during that time. Having done that, when you reach 1 crore, now you need more funds to move from 1 crore to 20 crores. Now, the kind of fund requirement may not be the criteria under which World 5 operates. So we would say, hey, you need to go to a next level investor. We will connect you with them, or you can also go on your own. But when a new fund comes in, who will start looking at investing anywhere between 10 crores to 20 crores? Now, at that time, we as fund managers could take a call to say, okay, hey, we look at this as a good business. The multiples are happening for us, but we would now want to exit because we have to give our money back to the investors. So we could take an exit and another fund would take over to take care of you and your journey. So for us, that relationship building capability in you becomes very critical for us, because if you're not very good at relationship building, we might find it difficult to exit. And if we find it difficult to exit in the first place, when we feel it, we will not even invest with you. The other thing that we have observed in most pitch decks that we receive is, he comes to us and says, my revenue generation right now is at about 5 lakhs in the whole year. Next year, I intend to generate about 20 lakhs. The third year, I intend to generate 50 lakhs. But he comes to you with a proposal saying, I need an investment of 2 crores. Now, for us, the math does not add up. You are at 5 lakhs. You're talking of doing 20 lakhs. In the third year, you're talking of doing 50 lakhs, which is, let's say, cumulative 70 lakhs. Why would you want 2 crores? We don't understand. That means in 3 years' time, you're not even going to break even. Then we would question whether we should put our money with this kind of a startup. So for us, you need to ask for the right amounts. Of course, we have our own method of valuation. But what is important is you should also know what are you asking for and have clear justification of how you want to ask for that money. We look at your capability to plan your work and work your plan. If you have that in you, great. We will even question you with what if scenarios to say, what if this were to happen? How would you handle it? So we sort of get him to start thinking for the future. If this were to happen, what would I do? If that were to happen, what would I do? So from project to project, when we ask these questions, we look at the way the entrepreneur handles it. And whether he's willing or whether he's rigid for the changes that could happen in the marketplace. Like, for example, nobody anticipated COVID would happen. I'm sure a lot of startups gave, you know, great projections before the COVID thing happened. But during COVID, a lot of these startups had actually, they had to fold down because they didn't have capabilities to figure out how to handle their business during this downturn. And only the ones who were smart enough to conserve cash, do downsizing at the right time, were able to survive and are still continuing to survive. Out of probably, I'll give you these stats. Most of the startups actually fail. So it's very critical to understand these aspects before we decide where we want to fund. Developing an elevator pitch is also not something which is so easy and forthcoming to everybody. Not all of us are capable of making great presentations. But you don't have to necessarily do everything yourself. You can always go to an expert who can help you. There are so many startups we come across who are guys who have great ideas, great execution thoughts, but he's not capable to present it. Then we have to help him polish it. So then we ask him to use resources. We ask him to use advisors who can help him with the idea that somebody can translate his great idea and put it onto a presentation deck, which as fund managers, we can use to evaluate whether we should invest with him or not. Of course, we keep telling all startups that don't give up. We are selfish there because at the end of the day, once we have put our money, we want our returns. If you give up, our money is gone. So for us, it's very critical you don't give up. This is what the statistics is. So out of every 100 startups that happen, 75 of them fail, 75. And if you look at the overall global situation, there are countless startups which fail every year. But the reasons are not countless. The reasons are standard. There are a couple of key reasons why these startups fail. If you were to evaluate all those startups which have failed, you will see those statistics which show up. I'll share some of them with you. So to understand the statistics, 1 in 5 million unfunded startups end up being a billionaire club. Out of every 1,000 startups that meet venture capitalists, only 2 get funding. For us, we are bridge funding guys. So for us, the thumb rule is every 50 startups that I look at, there is one startup that I could probably find whom I'll invest in. So which means I have to go through 40 startups before I can say, hey, this is the one I'm going to put my money in. And for every funded startup, there is 1 in 10,000 which ends up becoming the billionaire. And if you look at the reasons, in the first place, they were not able to identify what the real problem was. They saw a perceived problem and they thought that is the real problem. And they went about solving that perceived problem. The second is, a lot of startups are not willing to discuss, to understand whether that prototype that they're working on, is it really going to solve that real problem or not? Thirdly, we've seen people who have created startups because sabne kiya hai to maine bhi shuru karna hai. Mere ko bhi billionaire banna hai. Mere ko bhi Flipkart banna hai. But main kaam nahi karna chahta. Mehnat nahi karna chahta. That passion is not there. And this, for us as investors, couple of calls, couple of discussions, which we do over VC calls, in these times, otherwise we do it face to face, we look at your body language and we're able to understand how much of real passion is there inside you. We also look at what kind of skills do you have, what do you lack. Another thing that we do at World 5 is that when we decide to invest with a company, we also look at if you are weak, let's say in marketing, then we will look at, can we support him on the marketing side and help him scale up that business? If we think, yes, we can support him, then we would invest. Let's say if he is strong in all aspects, but he's weak in technology side of it, we would, and we are not good at technology side of it, we would say, boss, you need to get somebody to work with you on the technology side. Otherwise, we will not invest with you. Because we know that skill is critical for that business. The other aspect is cash burn. Many a times this has happened. There is a story where a fund manager who was flying from Delhi to Jaipur was flying economy class, and they were meeting up with some startups who were invited from Bombay and from Delhi, and they were meeting in Jaipur. And he happened to notice a young startup entrepreneur who was sitting in business class. And at the meeting, he realized that this boy has come for fund, but was traveling business class. So to us, that startup is not somebody we would ever put our money, because he was spending money on himself rather than on building up his startup. So for us, somebody who ignores cash burn is not a guy to invest. And of course, a lot of people have great ideas, but they just don't know how to go about raising capital. Many a times I've come across technocrats who have great business ideas, but when we tell them, can you prepare a cash flow for the next 36 months? And he says, what is cash flow? I don't know how to prepare cash flow. So we advise him to go to a CA or to an accounts guy who can guide him on how to prepare a cash flow. So he will provide all his inputs and the CA will prepare the cash flow and give it to him. And when that cash flow is what the entrepreneur sees, he realizes where he stands and what he needs as funds for running the enterprise. The other area which we realized for failures is that a lot of entrepreneur founders want to hold on to the equity, 100% of it. They don't want to share it with the team. They don't want to create co-founders. Now at World 5, or for that matter, any investor, we are very, very particular to say, we will not invest in a company which is a one-man show for very many reasons. One, what if something happens to that leader? As far as we are concerned, we need to be dispassionate, insensitive. If something goes wrong with his health, and he ends up having a problem, what happens to our funds? Because we've invested and we cannot empathize with him at that time. We need the enterprise to still continue. So for us, a good team is very critical. It also shows us the leadership skill of that leader. There are some entrepreneurs whom we have seen who are working primarily with one objective, which is to create an enterprise, scale it up in a short time, make it look larger than life, and go and sell it to somebody. The foundation of such scaled up enterprises is so weak that with one bad decision, the whole building can collapse. So we look at the journey that is happening with the startup. We look at how his growth is happening in terms of sales numbers. We look at how his growth is happening in terms of his costs. And we review that to understand, when is that hockey stick happening? And is it happening on a strong foundation or on a weak foundation? There are a lot of people we have seen in the startup entrepreneurs who tend to say, yaar, aaj ka flavor ye hai. So let's follow this flavor. Today, everything is artificial intelligence. So let's talk that, you know, we are doing a lot of artificial intelligence work. Whereas the enterprise actually is a pure plain enterprise. Main bas idli ke packets bana ke main supply chain manage kar raha hu. Koi usme artificial intelligence ka kaam hai nahi. But more fad hai, toh I will present as, you know, we are using artificial intelligence to identify our customers and their behavioral pattern. It's not true. So we know what is fad, what is reality. For us, data is very critical. So for us, when we look at a startup, we ask him for historical data, we ask him for projection data. Many a time we marry the artificial, I mean the historical data with the projection data, they don't marry. Historically, he has been doing 30,000 rupees per month, and he talks ki mereko aaj investment mila, main kal se jo hai 50 lakh ka business karunga. And kaise karoge? He doesn't know. And then he starts telling us stories. Then we look at the other reason why most of these startups fail is the entrepreneur, because he thinks he's putting his own money, he's putting his own time, he starts micromanaging. He's even asking the peon, bhaiya, tumne kitne cup chai piye? That kind of an approach which is there with the entrepreneur spoils the entire business flavor. And for this, before we invest in a startup, we tend to visit the premise of the startup to see what is the real working that is happening. And we go there unannounced. We don't even tell them when we come. We stand outside his building and say, by the way, we happen to be here. So we thought we'll just drop in for a cup of coffee. So he can't get down to, you know, showcasing his enterprise. We will see what the reality is. Then we also look at people who have failed because they hung on to that wrong idea, that wrong implementation, the wrong pricing, the wrong marketing tactics that he used. And these are reasons why many of these startups have failed. Those 75% of the startups failed for all these possible reasons. As an investor, I mean, as a fund, I represent investors. So which means I would look at the psyche of the investor and figure out as their manager, how am I going to look at investing in a startup? So when I look at a startup, I would look at whether you're solving a real problem. Is there a real need in the first place for this solution? And does the leader have the right DNA to take it forward? What's the kind of culture he's creating in his organization? Does he have a good team? Does he have the right mentors? For us, this is also very critical. When we look at the presentation deck from the entrepreneur, we look at who are his advisors. When we look at the advisor panel, we know that this guy has got the right kind of mentoring happening and he should be on the path to succeed. While a lot of them may not agree, and an entrepreneur, because he's small and he's trying to build the organization, many a times he ends up taking shortcuts and he doesn't operate within the legal framework. To us, we have a kind of red mark against somebody who does not operate in a legal framework. There's a reason for it, because we know when he scales up tomorrow, if he maintains the same attitude, it will cause problems. We also look at whether he signs contracts, whether he uses the legal approach to making documentation. Also, we see how easily does he talk about his idea. We have come across so many startup entrepreneurs who will not talk to us till we sign an NDA with them. And of course, as advisors, fund managers, we sign an NDA because we are more interested in identifying a great idea and funding it. So to us, the secrecy of your idea is as important to you as to us is. And we also will help him and guide him to ensure that whatever IP he creates, he registers it so that there is value. And we also ensure that the IP is registered in the company's name and not in its individual's name, because the value lies with the company in that case. And more importantly, we also look at the entrepreneurial journey to understand whether he is writing the right amount of blogs. Does he write on technical topics? Very critical, because it shows whether he's a hollow person or a person with solid background. We like people who ask us questions. Even if you're an entrepreneur coming for funds, ask us questions. We are happy to answer. We like entrepreneurs who start slow and systematically grow their business. We like entrepreneurs who's a little tight-fisted is not wanting to say that bhai mujhe 2 crore de do aur mere se 50% equity le lo. No, we like guys use mere ko aap 1 crore do, main aapko sirf 10% dunga. So beyond funding, we look at what we can add as value. We review their business plan. So we look at their future plan. We look at their past data. We look at their cash flow statement, because that is where we will see how much is the negative cash flow that is there over a period of 3 years. That is the amount which he really wants for anybody to fund him. And then we can decide on what valuation should we look at, or should we look at doing a debt funding. And then, of course, the question for us, very critical, is can we exit over a period of 3 to 5 years? So this is how we understand the entrepreneur and the startup, and we convert all that data and get him to put it into his pitch deck. Now, you need to remember, when you come to the pitch, that it is your one-time window of 10 to 15 minutes in which either you make it or you break it. And you have 10 slides. Just try to imagine, in 10 slides, you have to tell your whole story, and it should be exciting enough for the investment community to say, "Is pe paisa lagana banta hai." And the other thing is, we'll have a Q&A of another 15 minutes in which anybody in the investment committee could ask you questions about your enterprise, about your idea, about your figures, about your numbers, and you should be confidently answering them. But there could be situations where you don't have an answer. Please be honest at that point of time to say, "I need to go back and check, but I'll come back to you and tell you what the answer is." Don't fib. Don't tell us stories, because all these guys who sit in the panel are all experienced people with 25 to 35 years of experience who have seen the world, and they can make out if you're fibbing. The other thing is, before you go to any pitch deck, very important for you to understand who is there on that panel. There is always somebody in the fund advisory system who is your point of contact before you come to the pitch deck level. You can always ask him or her as to who all are going to be there in the investment committee. You can look up the people and their profiles so you understand. And you might need to tweak around your pitch so that you respond to those investment community guys in the right manner, so that if you know the audience, you know what you're talking, you know what will sell. Don't put any false or misleading information. And most important, let it not be a lecture like what I am doing right now. It should be a nice storytelling. You should be able to tell it in the form of a story which is interesting, because you have to imagine that that investment committee is going through, let's say, 5 or 10 pitches in that day. He has to remember your particular pitch. So it's very critical for you to ensure that you tell it in a manner where they remember you and your story. Please keep a watchful eye on your body language, because you say something and you look here and there, that guy is watching you. He knows what you're doing, what you're saying. Like I said earlier, don't get scared of questions which the investor may ask. And one question which an investment committee will always ask is, what is your exit strategy? Because he, as an investor, is also looking for exit. So if he aligns with your exit strategy, he finds it easier to put money into your setup. And last but not the least, to introduce your team, because the investment committee does not want to see you, they want to see who are the people with you. And what should the pitch deck typically cover in those 10 slides that you have? Should very clearly space out what the problem, what the opportunity is. You must spell out what is your product, what is your solution. Another critical thing that you must definitely add in your pitch is, what is the unfair advantage you have vis-a-vis other people in the same space? So if you say that I am a Paytm and I can do this, 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 and MobiQuick can't do it, so-and-so PayU can't do it, so-and-so wallet can't do it, is what we will look for, that unfair advantage. But that is what is going to be your USP. So that unfair advantage positioning is very critical. We even ask you to do competition mapping to show where you stand vis-a-vis competition. And that's where you need to clearly stand out on those parameters. You need to share your business model. You may add other information which may be there in terms of financial information, budgets, you know, what kind of traction do you have, specific details about your market, and all other aspects which you think will interest that audience to look at your venture in a positive manner. So in a nutshell, customize your pitch deck, follow that engagement statistics. Don't make it too verbose, don't make it too text. Don't use small fonts. It should be readable on the screen. And keep it short, keep it to the 10 slides and ensure that if the time that has been allocated to you, you stick to that time. If you overshoot the time, also the IC committee will look at you negatively. So if you have been allocated 10 minutes, keep a timer next to you, ensure that you move the slides fast enough and you complete it in 10 minutes. My sincere advice to most people who are wanting to come to a pitch level, practice a couple of times so that you know that your time management on every slide is sufficient enough to tell enough about that slide. At the same time, it's enough to ensure that the overall time of the presentation is maintained. So in a nutshell, we look at that entrepreneur, we look at his DNA, we look at his team, we look at his idea, we look at how he is executing, we look at the cash burn, we look at do we have exit opportunities before we take a call saying that I would like to invest with this company. With that, I come to the last slide of the presentation. And I hope you have been able to pick up a few nuggets in this presentation that I've shared with you.
Thank you so much, sir. Any amount of thanks given to you would be less. The information that you gave to us and the ease with which you gave us that information. We're so very thankful to you. And dear students, the Q&A session is on now. So please shoot up your questions.
So any potential entrepreneurs there? Would you like to ask some questions or clarify your doubts regarding startup pitch? Or anything otherwise related to
You can ask anything under the sun.
I don't know whether. But no, sir, questions, I have,
no questions will mean two things. I've done a great job. Or I've done such a lousy job. He says, "Ye toh bilkul upar se ud gaya."
Nahi, sir. It was a very comprehensive, but at the same time, very crisp presentation. And like I would take this that it was not, the presentation was not meant that how to prepare your elevator pitch, but it was also for any kind of presentations. Like I was about to say that like we keep on saying, telling students in the class how to make presentations, how should it look like, what should be the content on the slides, but I think yours was a perfect presentation, and I would ask my students to take learn it from sir, that how to make a presentation and how to present it. Generally, as you said, that too much of content should not be there. Generally, students, they overload these slides with information, so that with content rather, so that should not be there. So it was a very good presentation.
Thank you.
So I'll ask a question, sir. Like, do you, as you said, though it was half of it was answered by you in the middle of the presentation, that you said that artificial intelligence is a fad, and if anybody selling like idli batter and using artificial intelligence for it. But like my question is, like, do you give preference to technology-driven entrepreneurs?
Yes, Our focus, we are a niche fund, so we are very focused on deep tech space only. So okay. We will invest in B2B and we'll invest in B2B2C kind of ventures. We don't invest in B2C ventures at all.
Okay.
And so for us, when I say deep tech, it means artificial intelligence, machine learning, IoT. These are all, they are buzzwords, but we understand those buzzwords. And we look for enterprises which use that to scale the business.
Okay.
For example, there was a startup which we evaluated who would help organizations in recruiting at the entry level at BPOs, for example. And he had created a software which will conduct the interview over a laptop or a mobile handset and will watch, the bot will ask you, it's a robotics bot, which will ask you questions and will expect you to give answers. And that entire screen or the camera is actually watching you. And there are various 84 points of your face, which are mapped along with the way you speak, the way you your eyes shift, the way you behave. And then they would come out with a report to say, out of this 10,000 applicants, these 7,000 you can ignore. These 3,000 you can take it to the next level and evaluate. Just imagine an organization, let's say Accenture, for example. They have to do the 10,000 is brought down to 3,000. Mm-hmm. That task becomes so much more easier.
Right.
So, you know, there he is using artificial intelligence. There he is using machine learning to understand if the guy looks at the camera or he looks away from the camera or he looks down or he covers his mouth. Mm-hmm. These are all actions.
Right.
Show a certain character. Mm-hmm. And they're able to put those data points together and arrive at what is the characters of that interview profile.
Okay. Okay, sir, one follow-up question to that. So yeah. if technology is so much present everywhere nowadays, so like the traditional way of doing the business is obsolete now, completely obsolete? Like suppose if I want to start my startup and I want something very basic in nature, and I'm not a technology savvy guy, so can't I get investment or investors putting in their money in my venture?
You can, as long as you can present it. I may not be the right fund, but there could be many other funds who have different niches, so they can invest. For example, even the idli batter guy who's got into the business in Bangalore, ID, what he's done is something where he's got funding. For the simple reason, because they saw that there is a need that batter banana asaan nahi hai, and agar koi mujhe batter bana ke dega to main dosa bana lunga.
Okay.
He found that problem and he found a solution and he figured out how that batter can be kept in a manner where it will last for 3 to 5 days.
Right.
So that the supply chain problem can be taken care of. So now he has got a factory where it produces the batter. Mm-hmm. On the supply chain, it goes to the shop and it gets consumed.
Okay.
So he solved the problem there. Mm-hmm. So somebody like him would get funded. I don't believe that the retail business will go away or anything of that sort. Sorry, Kingsley, we will walk down to the market and prefer to pick it up than order on Amazon. Okay. It's not necessary that everything has to be ordered on Amazon.
Right.
And there are times when certain things, I mean, you don't go to Amazon. You charge in lagega, pata nahi aayega, nahi aayega.
Mm-hmm.
I can walk down to the market and pick it up right now.
Right.
So retail will remain. Aisa nahi ki nahi jaye. I will not vanish, but they'll all learn to coexist. All these channels.
Thanks, will coexist. Right, sir.
And there's somebody, Anmol, who has raised a question saying, can you give guidance on how to choose a good team? There is no yardstick to choose a good team. To be a good team is somebody with whom I can have a meeting of mind. So if I have an idea, I'm able to convey that idea to them. I'm able to convey my passion, and that passion, like a fever, gets translated to them. They are also equally passionate about it. So there are so many tick marks that you will have to go through before you say that this team is right for me. So it could be the compassion that you create with them. It could be that, you know, you could look at their capabilities. For example, you're strong in sales, somebody's strong in technical, somebody's strong in finance. So the team can get created in a different manner. And not necessarily that you find the best team members in college alone. But you can always start somewhere. You can start in the college. You can start, put together a team, see if you can work together and see how it goes. And like I said, be ready to quit if things are not happening. Don't hang on to that people or that idea beyond its duration. If you think that people with whom you're working are not the right kind of people, amicably part ways with them. Does not make sense. Everybody has parted ways, right? You look at Facebook partners, you look at Amazon partners, you look at Microsoft partners. Everybody has parted ways with whom they started their business. Because somewhere down the line, each one had a different objective in life. So it's not necessary that the same team continues. But it's important that whatever team you choose is a good team and stays with you.
So with your permission, I have a question to ask.
Sure.
So the very famous Ambani family of India, wherein one brother has been declared the richest man in India for the 13th time. And the other brother is close to being a pauper. So, sir, need your point of view on what is actually wrong with Anil Ambani and your advice on it. Like, how can he maybe bounce back?
No. I think I'm too small a fish, I would say, to comment on the Ambanis. But yes, whatever hearsay that we know is we can say that Mukesh is a true guju as far as business is concerned. He understands ki rupiya dala aur 10 rupiya nikala. Anil ka style alag hai. Wo 10 dalega aur 10 spend karega, 12 spend karega aur 2 ka kahin na kahin se jugaad karta rahega aur kahin na kahin jaake phans jata hai insaan. So I mean we are too small to comment on them, but yes, whatever we have seen, we understand from that journey that, you know, we should be clear as to what we want to do in life. And as entrepreneurs, we have to be very clear that the chavanni profit matters. If we see that flamboyance, then we know ki nahi ye to gawayega. Mereko agar dikhta hai ki wo 10 paise bacha raha hai, to banda sahi hai. Uska attitude sahi hai. But aisa nahi hona chahiye ki wo bhooka mar ke wo 10 paise bacha raha hai. We don't appreciate that behavior either.
Sir, in addition to this, I have another question. In the beginning of the slideshow, you talked about the DNA of entrepreneurs, would-be entrepreneurs. Sir, can you please clarify the meaning of the DNA, what actually it meant, the technical competence or the passion?
Everything. And for me, the entire checklist of an entrepreneur will include bhai wo banda kaisa hai. Like I said, you know, team, how does he handle his team? How much compassion is he able to generate with the team? How is he able to drive the team to work? There are times when, you know, you may not have money to pay salaries. Cash burn mein problem aati hai. But he's still able to keep the team together. He's self-motivated. He can motivate others to also continue with him at such times. So these things are there in the marketplace, and you can take care of these people during those difficult times. They remain with you. So these are some things which we look for in the DNA. There are people who we have seen who founder aake apne aap ko 10 presentation mein apne aap ko aage karta hai, team member ko batata hi nahi kaun hai. So we are also concerned ki bhai ye one man show to nahi hai. Fir hum uske cap table ko dekhte hain. Uske cap table mein shareholders kaun kaun hai. Pata chalta hai 100% equity owner wo akela banda hai. और बाकी जितने co-founders उसने हमको दिखाए हैं, none of them have got any equity in the company, even small. So then we know that there is a gap. तो co-founder सिर्फ नाम के लिए, क्योंकि हमने बोला है कि भैया एक founder होगा तो हम invest नहीं करेंगे. तो उसने किसी तरह तीन founder दिखाने थे तो दिखा दिए. But जब cap table में जाके देखते हैं, तो हमको पता चल जाता है कि बाकी लोगों को कुछ share दिया है कि नहीं दिया है. So these are all the things which add up to defining the DNA of the entrepreneur.
True, sir. Thank you. Sir, Anmol has one more question he has written there. Is college a best place to find team members?
Yeah, I thought I answered it while I was answering the first one. I said that, you know, it is not necessary that you have to find team members in the college alone. I think what you need to identify is, for example, I am an entrepreneur. I am good in sales. I need somebody who needs to be good in accounting. I need somebody who is good in technology. And if I'm not the guy who is in technology, then I need to find somebody who is in technology. So it could be a combination of people which you may find inside the college premise, or you could find outside the college premise. It could be just about anywhere. But to us, at least three people are critical for a startup. One is a marketing guy, one is the finance guy, sorry, the technology guy, and the finance guy. Or other than the CEO.
So any more questions from the students? Otherwise, I'll take the prerogative of asking last question. Yeah, for the students from the student side. So like for BTech students, there are many BTech students who come up with new ideas and they even start their own ventures also. But as you said, there were two things. One was cash flow, and the other one was exit strategy. So these students, they do not understand how to maintain the cash flow or how to plan for the cash flow and how to plan for the exit strategies. Like how can they do it at such a stage?
We normally recommend that it might call a bit of investment, but we say that please invest and get a good CA to work with you to prepare the cash flow. So okay. He will ask you the questions ki bhai, क्या क्या रेवेन्यू आएगा हर महीने कितना आएगा फिर आपका एक्सपेंसेस क्या है कितनी सैलरी देनी पड़ती है रेंट कितना देना पड़ रहा है एंड ही विल हेल्प यू प्रिपेयर अ कैश फ्लो कि आपको अगर ये बिजनेस करना है और आज आपका रेवेन्यू इतना है और आपको इस रेवेन्यू से इस रेवेन्यू तक जाना है इन द नेक्स्ट 36 मंथ्स देन व्हाट विल बी द टॉप लाइन व्हाट विल बी द बॉटम लाइन व्हाट विल बी द एक्सपेंसेस ही विल हेल्प यू पुट दैट इनटू प्लेस एंड देन यू मे एंड अप विद अ फिगर व्हिच शोस दैट यू आर गोइंग टू हैव अ क्यूमुलेटिव cash loss of, let's say, 2 crores. Mm-hmm. Then you know that ye 3 saal tak ye project jo hai, koi return nahi dega, and you will need funds of 3 crores. But suppose you do it over 3 years and you find out that you become cash positive by the time the third year starts, then we know that for the first 2 years you may be having a loss, but third year se aap profit mein aa rahe ho. So then we look at the data and say, ठीक है हमारे को 2 साल की इसको फंडिंग देनी है उसके बाद वो सेल्फ सस्टेन्ड रहेगा और वो आगे बढ़ाएगा आपके बिजनेस को. So that is what we look at when we do cash flow. Okay. Then when it comes to the other point, which was what is that?
Exit strategy.
See, the exit is something which is not easy. It's a lot of trial and error. बहुत सारी चीजें हम सोचते हैं कि ऐसे होना चाहिए ऐसे होगा बट होता नहीं है. So this is something which one will learn with iterations about that business. For example, agar maine ek startup banaya which is doing some aspect of the wallet business, for example. So exit strategy ho sakti hai ki ye main agar bada bana ke acha bana do to ho sakta hai ki Paytm ke paas ye nahi hai aur Paytm mujhe acquire kar lega.
Okay,
so that's an exit strategy.
Okay. Okay.
और मैंने अच्छा प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट किया जिससे फॉर एग्जाम्पल देयर वाज अ स्टार्टअप कि यू नो टुडे एज अ वेंडर व्हेन यू आर कमिंग ऑन अमेज़न एंड यू वांट टू पुट पिक्चर्स ऑफ योर प्रोडक्ट्स इट्स नॉट सो इजी फॉर एवरीबॉडी कि मैं अपने प्रोडक्ट के सारे पिक्चर्स लूँ सही तरीके से उसको पिक्सल में डालूँ सही लाइटिंग इफेक्ट दूँ और उसको फिर मैं प्रोडक्ट को एनहांस करके मैं अपलोड करूँ अदर स्मॉल स्टार्टअप्स हु हैव कम अप हु हेल्प यू डू दैट पार्ट
राइट
Now, if that product becomes very easy to use for that small vendor, then what is going to happen is that Amazon will see it and Amazon may come and say, wow, it's a great idea. Isko hum khareed lete hain. And we will give that as a feature for any vendor onboarding in Amazon. Mm-hmm. So that's how you have exit strategies happening.
Okay. Got it. So that means students have to plan for it before they go for pitching to the investor.
Yes, at the pitching time, this question will be asked.
Okay. Mm-hmm. because that is beneficial for the investor also.
Absolutely. वो बहुत clear है. वो आप मारवाड़ी है, उसने पैसा लगाया, 2% मिलेगा तो मैं लगाऊंगा, नहीं मिलेगा तो नहीं लगाऊंगा. तो उसको एग्जिट दिखना चाहिए. अगर एग्जिट right. नहीं दिखेगा वो नहीं करेगा.
ओके ओके. So sir, I think there are no more questions and we are on time. It's 4:50. So thank you so much, sir, for sharing your experiences with us. It was a very enlightening session and a learning session too. And as I said, it was not only just related to startup or pitch-in, but it was also related to general presentations also. Thank you so much, sir. And the way you presented and the way you interacted, it was very nice. Thank you so much, sir, once again.
My pleasure. I hope the students have learned something out of it. Agar 10-20% 30% bhi leke jayenge, I'll be happy.
Sure, they will, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Ashish. And thank you, ma'am, for organizing this. Thanks a lot.
Most welcome, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Can we all leave? Ashish sir, photo le liya.